High-NA EUV is ASML's next-generation lithography product, and is popularly marketed as the machine to save Moore's Law. ASML has shipped one early machine to Intel this year. The two are testing it as we speak. ASML is planning to do 20 high-NA EUV machines a year by 2028. A year ago, I did a video that updated us on high-NA EUV's latest progress. It was fun. Since another year has passed, time really flies. Let us dive in again into high-NA EUV technology and how are things going so far. One thing before we start, I plan to be in Antwerp, Belgium for IMEC's ITF World 2024 on May 21st and May 22nd. It's my first trip to Belgium. If you're in town, please let me know and would love to speak with you. Let us briefly summarize first what high-NA EUV actually is. High-NA EUV systems raise the numerical aperture, or NA, from 0.33 to 0.55. This would theoretically shrink the size of the machine's half-pitch lines some 64% to 7.5 or 8 nanometers. Raising the NA requires utilizing more light, but ASML found that it could not expand the size of the 6-inch UV photomask standard. More on this bit later. So ASML had to design its way around this restriction by using larger and stranger projection lenses. I have already covered that part in prior videos. No more lens talk, please. Zeiss is watching. Anyway, these major architectural choices, made many years ago in different times, set the stage for the technical and economic issues that ASML and its partners have needed to overcome to get their new machine ready for fab floors. One unavoidable consequence of these changes is that the mask field size, the area on the wafer exposed in a single exposed step, gets cut in half. The new field size is about 26 by 16.5 millimeters. This halving of the mask field size has major consequences. If the customer wants to make a die larger than this field size, and there are valid reasons for doing so, then ASML will need to do something called in-die stitching, or just stitching. Here we take the original design and cut it in two. Then we expose both masks with some overlap. This overlap section is called the stitching region and receives a double exposure. Now Intel has worked with mixed field sizes before. They called it 1-2 printing, but not like this. Setting aside the colossal mechatronics challenges of lining up the stitch, the overlay here is less than 1 nanometer, we need to consider all the weird dynamics at play inside the stitching region. The EUV photomask has two borders, a border for the mask image, and then a black border that is highly absorbent. This black border exists to prevent scattered light from affecting the die's neighbors, but it is still a little reflective, about 1 to 3%. This creates a tiny bit of a flash, kind of like a lens flare, which can blur the image. The border also collects the various mechanical stresses from the multi-layer deposition and cleaning processes. SEM images of the region find that the multi-layer does not drop evenly straight down. There is some undercut, theorized to be because of repeated wash stages. These mechanical displacements add complexity and can cause placement error, so we need to model out the interactions between the mask image border, and the black border. The transitions between those three areas are complicated, and reflections can wash out neighboring images. Recent experiments done by Siemens in conjunction with IMEC have suggested that a double exposure hurts image contrast for certain features like the contact holes used to wire up the different parts of a transistor. There was also some exploration done with nifty ways to cut the design. The simple thing would be to just cut it straight down the middle. The risk with that being that you leave some short tails on one side of the cut. If the stitch is not perfect, then we might be left with some cutoff polygons. But you don't always have to cut straight. First, smart cuts retain certain polygons across the border while leaving others out. And stagger cuts have a jagged shape that leave the ends of lines semi-isolated, making them slightly easier to print. And of course, chip designers can also just move critical structures like electrical connections away from the stitching area. To me, this feels like the most obvious solution, though it is unlikely to be a permanent one. In the same line, you can say, all this nicely benefits the ongoing chiplet and advanced packaging boom. The A15 Bionic chip inside the iPhone 13 is reported to be 8.58 by 12.55 millimeters. Skip the stitching headaches by doing a smaller compute chiplet with high-NA EUV-enabled nodes, then use advanced packaging to add on chiplets made using less sophisticated nodes like how it is with the AMD MI300. Or maybe ASML goes and makes an even crazier machine. A wild proposal from Kuamu Takahisa of the O2 Laser Laboratory caught my eye. A twin-scan lithography machine already does two wafer stages and chucks at the same time. Why not have it run two photomasks at the same time too? Crazy, right? But crazier things have happened. And early throughput simulations do show this new scan paradigm raising throughput by 1.5 times. The only question is, should we call it the twin-twin scan or the twin-scan scan? Vote now on your phones for your favorite. The resist receives the light and thus helps retain the design on the wafer. The main concern has been the much thinner depth of focus, which among other things means that we need to apply thinner layers of resist, maybe 40 to 60% thinner, to maintain good focus during exposure. Existing UV resists are organic chemical amplified resists, or CARs. They are mixes of carbon-based chemicals that have been used for lithography since the 1990s. Within the CAR, there is a photoacid generator molecule that creates acid when it absorbs UV light. The acid then causes other reactions during a post-exposure bake step to amplify the photons' impact like a photodetector in a chemical. The issue is that CARs are relatively transparent to 13.5 nanometer UV light, which makes their use rather less than ideal. So having a thinner layer of them means more issues in resolving a clear image. We also now have to more consider how the wafer's own reflectivity affects the exposed image. And it also heightens the impact of stochastics, random isolated defects that basically cannot be avoided because, you know, quantum. Tests done at ASML Taiwan found that cutting the CAR layers by 30 and 50% introduce 3 to 7 times more defects as recorded by electron beam inspection. The resolved images were also fuzzier, suffering more noise. The ASML Taiwan team notes that if we expect to use thin CAR layers for high NA EUV, we will need to accommodate these defects in the recipes and use aggressive metrology to find and repair them. Or better yet, don't use CARs at all. I want to note a new highly promising resist candidate, metal oxide resists, or MORE. I don't know if that name was chosen deliberately, but MORE for Moore's Law, ha. Huh? It is not clear to me how MOREs exactly work. If I knew, then someone broke an NDA somewhere, but I wonder if it has to do with the introduction of tin atoms to stop and absorb energy, like how early contrast fluids for CT scans use the heavy metal thorium. Anyway, with a MORE layer, you can print features with less line width roughness, which is good because you want cleaner lines, using slightly less UV light, which is good because it means less time in exposure and thus more throughput, than you would need with an equally thin layer of CAR. The tin content also means that the resist becomes highly resistant to etch processes after it undergoes the post-exposure bake step. We shouldn't take this benefit too lightly, it is really helpful. Though there seemed to be an issue with this particular post-exposure part, unspecified atmospheric conditions between the exposure and bake steps can cause bridging, pattern collapse, and pinching, visual names for certain types of print defects. Recently, Tokyo Electron started talking about a new method and tool modification they call Enhanced Sensitivity Developer Technology, or ESPERT. They say ESPERT, marketing needs to look at that name again, can modify the chemical image to fix or avoid defects and get very tight patterns. As I mentioned, CARs have been the photoresist of choice for nearly 30 years now. So if the fabs switch from CARs to MORs, it will cascade throughout the whole lithography stack. A lot of existing things that worked before will have to be thrown out. The leading supplier of MORs is Inpura, which first spun out of Oregon State University, but was acquired by the Japanese chemical company JSR in 2021. Considering its emerging importance, a great get for the Japanese. Metrology is going to be playing a huge role in high-end EUV. I've not much mentioned the importance of metrology, which is the study of measurement, but the high-end EUV era will once more grow the role of semiconductor metrology and inspection. Stochastic failures will become more frequent, and it is already slowing down the process cycle. More metrology measurements have to be done to find and flag these fails. At the same time, smaller resolutions also bring down the minimum size of the defects. Checking line width roughness is now even harder because we are now measuring in the sub-nanometer dimension. And how do we guarantee a consistent resist layer when the layer itself is just 10 to 30 nanometers thick? This challenges existing tools, which are based largely on optical principles, and opens the door to electron beam-based metrology and inspection. Essentially, mutant electron microscopes for finding defects that optical tools cannot see. IMEC has started to bring tools like transmission electron microscopes into their labs and integrating them into the line. And there are papers detailing something called massive metrology, which sounds like a mobile game, but describes a need to review many features at the same time. Hitachi and IMEC collaborated on a device that can inspect a million contact holes at once for defects. And it is not just stochastic defects to inspect for instance, the flatter depth of focus means that not only the resist layer, but also the wafer itself has to be far thinner, you know, all these things. We're going to need a lot more metrology and inspection tools here, and the fabs must pay through the nose for all of it. As you might be guessing by now, we are coming towards a massive increase in the computer's role in lithography, computational lithography. The use of anamorphic lenses that demagnifies one side more than the other, the fact that there's now a hole in the middle of the final projection lens, the effects of the thinner resist layer, and the fact that the mask shops aren't changing their methods or tools, this all needs to be incorporated into the computational lithography methods used to produce the rules and simulations for today's EUV masks. It is an exceptional challenge. In a prior video, I talked about CoolLitho, the library of algorithms from NVIDIA that helps make it easier to do certain computational lithography processes. Stuff like optical proximity correction, modifications we make to the chip design in order to make it print better, or inverse lithography technology, completely reworking a chip design backwards to make it print optimally. NVIDIA recently announced in March 2024 that TSMC and the EDA firm Synopsys has started to put CoolLitho algorithms into action. NVIDIA noted how CoolLitho helped optimize the OPC module in Synopsys' mask synthesis solution Proteus, accelerating speed and saving users many hours of time. It amuses me to think of TSMC making GPU wafers for NVIDIA and then buying them back from NVIDIA at a way, way higher markup, but I think this trend of using AI and parallelism in litho will only strengthen. I also want to call out TSMC's dire need for more accurate computational lithography models to predict what are called hotspots, certain areas in the design which are more susceptible to open circuits or short circuits for whatever reason. Hotspot detection is more of a general lithography thing, but they will become even more desirable in the high-end EUV era because of all the stochastic issues and the machine's high cost of ownership. Anything to cut the number of defects at the design level is highly appreciated. It feels like something solvable, and over the years there have been a number of papers touching on it, but traditional pattern matching methods miss new types of hotspots, and machine learning methods ring too many false positives. The search continues. High-end EUV's single biggest competitor isn't a machine made by the Chinese or Japanese, rather it is another ASML machine. The alternative to buying a $300 million high-NA EUV lithography machine would be doing multiple passes of standard low-NA EUV. Right now, it looks like the economics are not quite in high-NA's favor, just yet. As I mentioned in the last video, lithography's cost of ownership is calculated as depreciation cost divided by the product of raw throughput and equipment utilization. Assuming you are utilizing the equipment 100% of the time, which is impossible, then you can only lower ownership costs by raising the throughput, which is measured by wafers per hour processed. The thing that most concerns me are throughput issues tied to the low power source. If you raise a lithography machine's resolution, then unless you also upscale its power source, then the throughput will go down. The reason for this is, again, stochastics. We need more photons hitting the photoresist to overcome the fact that a certain percentage of them will quantum their way to where they shouldn't be. If your power source cannot generate enough EUV photons because it is underpowered, then the only way to compensate is to hold the wafer under the power source for longer. This slows throughput and hurts cost of ownership. Right now, ASML has not raised the power of the power source enough to compensate for the resolution. They will try to do this by changing the drive laser and accelerating the frequency of the tin droplets to 60,000 a second. To make a design to do this, we need to measure and model the behavior of molten tin at the higher than atmospheric pressures inside the ASML machine. No instrument nor modeling software exists for this, yet another metrology gap to plug. The US's National Institute of Standards and Technology is working on it, as well as the Chinese. If we can pull all that off, will the power gain be enough? I wonder. But there seems to be no impending desire to change the EUV power source design, and the industry seems super insistent that synchrotrons are not the answer. Moreover, we have the half-sized field, the impending need to change the whole resist stack, the gaps in current metrology and inspection, and so on. Taking this into account, it seems like the high NA EUV ecosystem is still a bit immature. It is good that Intel is trial running these devices with ASML and helping to work out the kinks. They're very smart and will make many breakthroughs, I reckon, but it's going to cost them. Luckily, Intel is awash in cash and time. I think it is somewhat telling that TSMC has not yet started buying these machines in bulk. It indicates that TSMC wants to see the cost of ownership for the machine and its ecosystem go down. That gap needs to close somehow. Perhaps with that new nano-patterning technique, directed self-patterning, DSA can heal defects smaller than the pitch, reducing the number of errors. I'll look at that one later if people want to hear about it. For additional information, I suggest reading ASML Dilemma and Intel's 14A Magic Bullet, Directed Self-Assembly, by Jeff Koch and Dylan Patel of SemiAnalysis. Great as always. Over the past few years covering the lithography industry, I have reflected, on a few things. One of the reasons how ASML has gotten to where it is now is because of its system integrator role, sourcing parts from a broad supply chain and retaining the job of putting them together. Like Boeing, but ouch, let's not make those comparisons right now. But the downsides of that is that you are dependent on those companies to cooperate with you on the future roadmap. Who knows what high-NA EUV might look like today if the mask makers agreed to expand the size of the masks. Intel's Pat Gelsinger has told friend of the show Ian Cutress at More Than More in an interview that he wants ASML to explore larger masks. But the mask makers won't agree to do that unless TSMC and Samsung sign on, giving either a veto on technological progress in the industry. It's the 450mm wafer upgrade problem all over again. ASML has been ninjaing its way around that refusal ever since. As EUV advances down the line, there might be an argument for ASML to leave some of its former approach behind and take more components in-house. This would greatly expand the company's breadth, dilute its focus, and raise its own cost structure, so it should not take this decision lightly. But if an integrated approach helps them get these things out faster and avoid these major headaches, then maybe they should at least consider it. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up to the Patreon, and maybe I'll go see you in Belgium.